Okay, so thanks for coming. So the goal of the lecture is to give a friendly introduction to a joint work with Peter Josen. Who is here this week. And at some point we thought that we could give the talk together and I would play the RAM realization and then he would play the Betty realization.
I will still interrupt you.
It would be a bit more serious than this. So it is about exponential periods and the kind of starting point is that there are some numbers which are not expected to be periods in the usual sense. And well, there are many numbers, but some interesting numbers are like the exponentials of algebraic numbers. Or the Euler-Mascheroni constant. Or the special values of the gamma function. Or maybe the special values of the Bessel functions. So for example, this one. So none of this is expected to be a period in the usual sense. But still, these numbers are somehow close enough to geometry, and we know so there are theorems about the transcendence properties of conjectures, and we would like to interpret them in a similar framework to the usual periods. And even in this list, there are very, very different cases because, for example, the special values of the gamma functions are not expected to be periods, but they are algebraic over the field of periods. For example, gamma of 1/2 is the square root of pi. And more generally, if you take this number to the power n, then it becomes a period. But, for example, this the exponentials should be very different. So they are expected to be a transcendental over the field of usual periods. And luckily, at the end of the talk, I will give some good explanation why this should happen. Okay, so we are going to work with exponential periods. I think this notion appears in print for the first time at the end of the paper by Concevitz-Aguier. And it was roughly at the same time where Bloch and Ong were looking at some arithmetic aspects of irregular connections, and they also found this kind of numbers. And so one can give an elementary definition, which as in the usual case doesn't have too much structure, so there are a few things you can do with this definition. But an exponential period would be something like okay, so first of all, what is a period? So in this elementary sense, so you are integrating some algebraic function with algebraic coefficients, and then you integrate over some domain which is defined by inequalities, which are also with algebraic coefficients. So this is something like it's a finite union and intersection of things like this, where h is again a function of this kind. Okay, so this is a usual period, and in the exponential case, you want to put here the exponential of a function of the same dimension. Okay. So all these numbers can be written in this way. Okay, so this would be the elementary definition, but I want to put a cohomology in immediately. So let's see how can we express this notion in terms of cohomology. So the usual thing to do is so you would like to integrate something closed. So if you consider the derivative of what is inside, then you find the differential you should put in your complex, and then you find that this is the usual thing twisted by the differential of f. Okay. So the setting will be the following: so k is a subfield of C, and then x is a smooth variety over k. So this is the usual setting where one defines periods. And the extra datum here is the function, so f is a regular function on x. And then we will think of it as a map to the affine line over k. Okay, and then the rank homology is defined as follows. So we take the usual, the rank complex of Keller differentials on x. But instead of putting the stereo derivative, we put the stereo derivative minus wedge with df. Okay, so this will be our the rank complex. And then a is the rank xf. So it's just the cohomology of this complex. Again, and in this way you get a k vector space of finite dimension. I will compute some examples in a moment.
You cannot put in any scaling parameter like d minus r df.
I'm not putting it, but I could. Yeah. This will give another cohomology theory. So in terms of something you will like. So you can take the direct image of the trivial D module here, do Fourier transform, then this is regular singular, it's not regular singular, it's smooth on GM, and then you can take any fiber. So this corresponds to a fiber one, mm-hmm. and what you are saying corresponds to a different point.
Yeah, right. Yeah. This is how we use it in practice.
Yeah.
You know, right.
Okay, so this is the RAM side of the story, and then there's a Betti side, which in this context is called rapid decay. So this is we want these integrals to be convergent, so this is the kind of conditions you need to put in the cycle. Okay? And the idea is that this is an algebraic differential, so if you want to guarantee that this converges, so the real part of S has to be very positive on the boundary of your cycle. Okay, so this is why the terminology rapid decay comes from. So a way to do this is so we take the complex points of the variety with respect to this embedding. So the map F becomes a map to the complex plane, and then in the complex plane. For each real t, and we can look at the half space where the real part is at least t, and we will consider relative cohomology. So maybe here, I want to consider the cohomology of the complex points relative to this region. Okay, let's say with q coefficients. Okay, so this as it is, it depends on t, and then this kind of formal way to get rid of this dependence is to take the limit as t goes to infinity. Okay, so this will be my definition of rapid decay cohomology. Okay, so what does the limit mean? So if you take a t prime bigger than t, so there are the thing corresponding to t prime will be contained here, so there are transition maps given by morphism of pairs, and you take the limit with respect to these transition maps. But this limit is, of course, in this transitions map will eventually be isomorphism, so as long as you take t enough so the topology of the map doesn't change, you will get an isomorphism. So a way to think of this is just the cohomology of the complex point relative to a very general fiber. Okay? Okay, so that's the Betti side of the story. And then there's a comparison isomorphism, so this is how the integrals are going to appear. Some comparison isomorphism. Okay, which says that tensor C, these vector spaces are canonically isomorphic. And then, so one can explicitly write down an isomorphism. If the variety X is affine, then cohomology class will be really the class of a differential, global differential. And then you can choose representative of your cycles here in such a way that the comparison isomorphism is given by integrating exponential minus f omega along gamma. Again, I will show some examples in a moment. Okay, so this is the comparison isomorphism, and then so far this makes sense for any subfield of C, and if K is inside the algebraic numbers, then we will call these coefficients exponential periods. Before discussing the examples, I want to talk about tensor product. Like in any, when you want to study periods using the theory of motives, this is really the crucial ingredient, that you have a tensor product of motives, and starting with this, you can format an Eichen category, and you can try to create Galois groups. So there's also a notion of tensor product in these cohomologies, and it is given as follows. So we will take the product of the varieties, the usual sense, and then put as a function what is usually called the Tom Sebastiani sum of the functions, which just means you take a function in its coordinate and you make the sum. And then there's a QNET formula in both cohomologies that says that this is isomorphic to the gradient tensor product of the two cohomologies. Okay, so many of the identities between these periods that you can have in mind will become tensor identities between these cohomologies. So the most obvious case is exponential of alpha times exponential of beta equals exponential of alpha plus beta. So this is an instance of this. Okay, so now, so this is like the kind of minimal setup. So now I want to give you examples. So the first example is if f is constant, so if the function f is constant, you see that both cohomologies are just the usual ones. Okay, so in the first case, df is zero, so let's get the Dirac complex. And in the second case, f minus one of st will be empty after a while, so you just get Betti cohomology. Okay, so.
Are they of finite dimension in general?
Yes, they are. They are always finite dimensional spaces.
Can one see it easily? Can one reduce it to
some topological form? There are many ways to see it, and easy depends on who you are. So, for me, the easiest way is that this can be computed on a compactification using a subcomplex of logarithmic differences, and then it's a complex of coherences on a projective variety, so it is finite dimensional. But you can also see it from the topological point of view. So this will be isomorphic to the same thing where you put f minus one of t, So he has one fiber. Mm-hmm. And then you have relative cohomology of two algebraic varieties. So
each thing in the limit is of finite dimension.
But the limit is not a true limit, so that's you take t big enough and it will just be this. Okay, so if f is constant, so this is just the rank homology of x and Betti homology of x. But you see that the Compison isomorphism is only the usual one if f is equal to 0. Okay, so if f is equal to 0, then we really find the usual setting of periods, so usual theory. And this is important to really have it inside, because we want to understand things like when these numbers are usual periods or not. So. But if f is a constant different from 0, then because of this factor, that this twist in the Compison isomorphism, you see that, for example, the exponentials are periods. And they are periods in the same kind of trivial way as algebraic numbers are periods. So if alpha is an algebraic number which is not 0, then you can consider the number field generated by it. And then you can take H0 of spec k and then put as a function minus alpha. And then this is one dimensional, and this is the comparison isomorphism is multiplication by the exponential of alpha. So it produces a period exponential of alpha. So let me call this thing capital E alpha. And then, as I said, the tensor product is E alpha tensor T beta equals E alpha plus beta. Not very surprising so far. Okay, but then, so this will be the basic ingredient for this exponential of algebraic numbers. We have theorems like the Lindemann Weierstrass theorem that says if you take alpha 1, alpha n, non-zero algebraic numbers which are Q linearly independent, then the exponentials are algebraically independent. Okay, so this classical result will be an instance of the period conjecture in this setting. And the key ingredient is this. Okay, so let's now do the gamma values, and then I will start by square root of pi. So in this case, you need to take as x the affine line over Q, and the function is x squared. And okay, so the Durand complex is very easy in this case. So it's just the Durand cohomology is just the cohomology of the complex where you send a polynomial g prime minus. So the derivative of this twice xg dx. And then this map is injective. And then h1 the one there is a co-kernel, and you see easily that the co-kernel is dimension 1 generated by dx. So everything in the image has degree at least 1. So you don't get this element, and then all the others are homologous to this one. Okay, so that's for the rank homology. And then for rapid decay, so you need to look at the complex plane, so the complex points, and then the region where the real part of x squared is very positive. So this is concentrated. So somewhere here and here, and then as a cycle in the cohomology, you can just take the real line. So the real line will become a like a generator of rapid decay homology. Yeah, you should. If you want to be very precise, you should think that you are cutting at some point, and then you are considered the compatible system of the segments as t goes to infinity. Okay, so what is the period in this case? So we need to compute the integral over the real line of exponential minus x squared dx. Well, and this is equal to square root of pi. And actually, the way you prove this identity, which is just by showing that the square of this is equal to pi, and then doing the change of variables to polar coordinates, you can use this to give an isomorphism of modes, exactly the same steps in the elementary proof. And then what you will prove is that this cohomology, if you take the tensor square, then this is isomorphic to, well, first of all, a usual motif, and this motif is H1 of the affine conic x squared plus y squared equals to 1. Okay, so this is the kind of thing that replaces the change of variables cosine of theta and sine of theta directly. And so we know that this this conic is a GM if your base field contains square root of minus 1. So this will be a Q of minus 1 if minus 1 is a square in K. And then it will be an acting twist of this in general. So in general it will be Q minus 1 and then times the acting motif of K square root of minus 1. Okay, over here. So you see that in if you are working, for example, over Q of I, then this guy really deserves the name of the Q of minus 1 half. And this is consistent with many other things. So for example, there's a filtration on the rank homology, which is called the regular Hodge filtration. And then it will associate to H1 of A1, X1, X2, Hodge type 1/2, 1/2. Okay, so it's pure of weight 1, and then the Hodge type is this. Okay, so that was the question of X squared.
So you need to
work a little bit because okay, so the thing is when you consider the if you just follow the recipe there, you will find that this is the cohomology, so you will find that this is H2 of A2 with the function x squared plus y squared. Okay? So this corresponds to the square of the integral is the integral on R2 of exponential minus x squared minus y squared dx dy. Okay? And then when you do your change of variables, so now you put x r cosine y r sine, then actually you find an integral between 0 and infinity. So you will find something like this in your okay. You find, I think, what do you find? You find this right, the product of these two things. And there's a small technical issue that here you are integrating from 0 to infinity, and not from minus infinity to infinity. If you integrate from minus infinity to infinity, then you get 0. and because it's symmetric. So you need to introduce a cohomology in the middle and then do like a kind of tic tac to prove this. I can show you the details. But so that you will write an obvious mapping cohomology and then it will be zero. And it will be zero because this integral from minus infinity to infinity is zero. Okay, so that was the case at x squared. And you see already there we find some new phenomena like square root of q minus 1. And more generally, so you can consider again the affine line, but now with the function x to the end. So now the cohomology will be of n minus 1. And
what happens with just x?
X to the end. For x is zero. As the cohomology is zero. Because you are considering the complex complex g goes to g prime.
The file is just from the dimensions.
And then I guess you also see directly on the cohomology. And the Betti set. Yeah, so this is why I take at least two. And in this case, this has dimension n minus 1. And the RAM is generated by dx, x dx, up to x n minus 2 dx. Okay, these would be generators. And then on the Betti side, so well, you find a similar picture, but now it's on the lines with slope or the roots of unity of order n. Okay, so like the inverse image of the half space will be disjoint union of regions like this. So these are the lines with the slope, the roots of unity. And then as cycles, you can take cycles starting up to infinity, going to zero, and then going up to one of these lines. Okay. This is kind of gamma 1. And then you have a gamma 2, and so on. Okay. And then, so the integrals are, you are integrating exponential minus x to the n, and x to the j minus 1 dx on the gamma i's. And then this is up to an easy cyclotomic factor. This is the value of the gamma function at j over n. Okay, so. And then if you want to get rid of this factor, you can just integrate. So you can just integrate on minus gamma 1 minus gamma n minus 1. The cycle of integration is one of these. Right, so you start at. Okay. So it's a compatible collection of things where you start at big T and then you go up to distance T here. And it goes to infinity. Okay. And I think in this way you should get the. A gamma function as a motivic gamma function, right? That's put in this setting, which is a bit more general.
Yeah, so this is like a standard part in the basic ground world, right?
Maybe not exactly this one.
Okay.
I th- think what I'm going to write next is probably closer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so yeah, so again, there will be this irregular Hodge filtration on the cohomology, and then this will have Hodge. So these differences are pure for this filtration, and then they have this Hodge type. And then for example, the relation to usual periods, when you take this number to the power n, then you can write it as a product of the values of the beta function, and then this will be periods of a Fermat hypersurface. And this also exists at the level of cohomology. So what you can prove is, you can prove the following. So you take this motif here, you take a tensor power of another degree, so n and n integers at least 2, and there's an action of roots of unity here multiplying your function by like primitive root of unity, so you can act diagonally on the tensor product, and you can take the invariance. Okay. And the statement is that this guy is a usual motif, and it is correct. So it is cohomology. So it's the cohomology of the Fermat hypersurface. This one. So it's MN. So middle cohomology. So it's the middle primitive cohomology twisted. This is something that was first proved by Anderson. So he has a paper where he introduces something called interior motifs. And then these interior motifs are nothing but this case of A1 with x to the n. And then he proves this. Okay. And from this you can get many of the properties of the gamma function, so you can get, for example, the reflection formula for the values at rational numbers.
Okay, I must say that the schema is already in Weiss' paper, 48.
In whose paper?
Andrea Weiss.
Okay.
Well, Mercedes,
okay.
Shows that.
I didn't know this.
Oh. Sorry, you mean the projective?
Yes, this is the projective from a hypersurface in P n minus 1.
So this way you get all products of gamma ki over n with the sum of ki's is 0 log n.
Yes, so this comes from,
the cluster
from exactly from this condition.
For that condition.
Yeah. Yeah. It should be if and only if, and of course the other part we don't know, but you can get it as the motivic level. Okay, so that's that was the gamma, the gamma example.
Now you've introduced both a fractional tail twist and here also fractional Hodge numbers.
Yes.
But that's just because of this special example, x to the j. If you have something else, then j over n will no longer be a rational number, so will you have also real tail twists and complex Hodge numbers? Or
like
where are we going?
So like that's a very special case because it has dimension 1. This has dimension n minus 1. And then it is also very special in the sense that you really get something that you could call a Hodge structure. Because you can define the complex conjugation, the opposite filtration, and they are really opposites. So in general, you will have the Hodge number, the Hodge type will be rational numbers.
Well, I mean, Don is asking, what happens if I take x, if I take the Mellon transform, if I take x to the n?
No, that wouldn't be the scheme. But if that wouldn't be a g and an e to minus n, because it's not algebraic. Mm-hmm. I'm asking, what if you take some other f, which is not simply x to the n?
Some other f in this set on a polynomial on the affine line, right? This is what you want.
Actually,
for any f here of degree n, this is still a basis of the rank homology. And the Hodge numbers will still be this shape. So it only depends on the poles of the function at infinity.
And how about this take twist? You're q of minus a half, but you didn't actually. You had your q of I minus a half.
Over q, yes.
Yeah, so over q, is there, I mean, do you have fractional twists in general?
No, over q, the only thing you can hope for is this one. So the square is...
Do you have a q of one-fifth, if it contains the fifth root of unity, or is it just special?
No, unfortunately, this is the only.
Oh, so you don't have fractional take twists?
No, only q.
The question, maybe this is too soon to ask this question, but what if we take away the crutch of the variety and we just look down on the affine line? I mean, this is somehow, we're doing something with connections on the affine line.
Sure.
You've cut out a sort of an interesting bunch of these irregular connections. Particularly interesting, these have rational structure.
Yes.
Which is not a general thing.
Yeah. Yeah, so you can just read everything over the affine line. Mm-hmm. And the kind of connections is a regular singular, which is really a Gauss-Manning tensor, the exponential of minus t, the coordinate of the affine line.
But that's a nice collection of connections to work with.
Yeah. Okay, so let's go to Euler's constant. This is little gamma now. And so this is minus the derivative of the gamma function at 1. And from this you get this integral representation. Okay, and then the idea now is to also write the logarithm as an integral. So you will write this as the integral from 1 to x of dy over y. And then you massage the formula and then you will find that this is an integral of exponential minus xy dx dy. So I will tell you where. So for the moment this is called a square minus triangle. Okay, so the situation is the following. So you look at the complex A2, and there are these four lines, x is equal to 0, x is equal to 1, y is equal to 0, y is equal to 1. Okay, and then I think you can guess what the square is. And this part of the integral is very well understood. So it's a transcendental number, it's the special value of an E function, it's algebraically independent with E, is everything you want. With your
yes, but over the square?
You have to remove the square. You've written minus the triangle.
Yes,
I'm
not talking about the triangle is to come.
So
yes.
say again, you said about the square.
I'm saying that if you just consider this integral, then you are very happy. Because...
What is this constant?
The Comparts constant.
The Comparts. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, so what I said is that you can prove that it is transcendental, and a way to prove it is to show that it is the special value of an E function. Okay, and then use the Xigesi-Blobsky theorem. So that's the so to say the compact part of the integral. But then we don't know anything about the gamma, so the bad news are coming from the triangle. So what is a triangle? So this is really a cycle that exists in this rapid decay cohomology. So you need to draw the level curves of the function x, y. So we have to say the function x, y. So this is where x, y is equal to t. And then we consider these cycles that as t goes to infinity. What I'm calling triangle, just because of this shape here. Okay. So the difference of these two things will give you the Euler constant.
It's also an iterator in there.
Yes. So
we throw some money on that.
It will come. So once you have this integral representation, you can. And the natural thing to do is to look at H2 of so A2, then relative to this union of lines, and then with the function xy. Okay, so I only define the cohomology of variety with a function, but you can also plug in as a variety. You just consider relative cohomology as a variety. So you will just do. If you have a subvariety y, you will just do this. Okay. And then the limit as t goes to infinity. Okay, so this representation shows that gamma is a period of this. And then you can compute it, and it has dimension 3. So we already see two cycles. And then there's a third cycle containing, so this is a GM, and there's a third cycle container. So for this we would need the Betti relaxation. You can write a differential formula which shows that this has dimension 3. Okay, but then there's a, we would like to have something of dimension as small as possible, so it's usual game. So then you can look at the point 1,1, and you can consider the blow up. So H2 tilde will be the blow up at the 1,1. And then you look at H2 of this with respect to the strict transform. And then with the induced function that I'm just going to call XY tilde. And then, so there's a blow up map, and it induces a map in the other direction. And this motif also has dimension 3, but the map has rank 2. So somehow these two cycles, when you do the blow up, they become one. And so you can then define M as the image of this map. Okay, so now I have dimension 2. And then a period matrix for this will contain the Euler constant and 2 pi I. Matrix. Is 1 gamma 0 2 pi a. Okay, the 2 pi a really comes from the period of this GM start to see. And well, this looks very much like an extension of Q0 by Q1. And it is actually 1, so it comes from, so M is an extension of q minus 1 by q 0. And it is an extension which does not come from user motif. So this, okay, I will come back to this.
So that was the logarithmic, the derivative of the gamma function at one.
And more generally, you can do higher derivatives. Okay, you can do higher derivative of the gamma function at one, or you could also do it as a rational number. And and then you find that this is minus 1 to the n integral between 0 and infinity of log n x exponential of minus x. And then you can play the same game, so there we really get an iterated integral. you can play the same game, and it will just be the same picture in several variables. So you will look at h n plus 1 a n plus 1 and relative to the boundary of the cube, and then with the product of the coordinates. Okay, this will contain this as a period. And you can actually compute.
But these numbers, this will just give gamma and zeta hogs.
Yes. So this is equal to n factorial pn of gamma theta 2 theta n, where pn is the homogeneous is the part of weight n in, so you consider the exponential of x1 plus x2 over 2 plus x3 over 3 and so on. So you declare that xi has weight I. Okay, so then you get the part of weight n. And this number is just this polynomial evaluated in gamma theta 2 up to theta n. The point is that you can really see this from computing the motif and computing the weights and the extensions and so on. So and actually there's a notion of good reduction. So this is a motif over Q, and it actually has good reduction everywhere. So in this exponential setting there's a notion a bit larger of like mixed state motifs over set or multiple theta values, where you, instead of regularizing brutally theta of 1 to 0, then you do the value of gamma.
Is there some sort of notion of fundamental group?
Not yet, but I hope it's coming. you can try to there are some things you can write down, and I still don't know if they are useful. It's something I would like to know better.
And you calculate the extension group of q minus 1 by q 0 in the new category?
So, conjecturally. this category of motifs is constructed as Norris, using Norris for noise and so on. In that setting, you don't have any control on the extension group, so we don't even know how to show that the usual category, the extensions of Q0 by Q1 are what we want. So there's no hope to construct, to show anything.
But there should be more extensions in classical data.
There are more, yes. So usual motif will be a full subcategory. The image is not closed on the extension. And in this case, actually, you can do a construction in the style of Bobrovsky, where you can compute the extensions, and then you can hope that they give the same answer. And the answer is that this is the only new extension. So
actually, if you do q0 by qn for n at least 2, then you don't get anything new, and then you get a copy of q in this way. Okay, so there was also an example with the Bessel function, but I guess I should state the theorem now. Okay, so the thing we proved with Petter and I only introduced two cohomology theories, but I was talking about motifs all the way, and somehow the summary of the theorem is that I can do this. So we constructed a Tanakian category, so there is a Tanakian. Category and exponent K, so for exponential motifs over K, and then it comes with fiber functors. So it's a fiber functor to vector spaces over Q called omega rapid decay. And also to vector spaces over K, so omega the bound. So in this category there are objects Hn, Xf, and then they will map to the cohomologies you already know. There's also, you can look at the scheme of tensor isomorphisms between these fiber functors. Maybe the round to the loop. Okay, and then there will be a complex point there. So there is a canonical complex point which induces the comparison isomorphism you already saw. And the upshot of this is that you can associate to this situation where you have a variety, a function at d of the commonality, you can associate a Galois group. Category generated by M, and it will be equivalent to the representations of an algebraic group over Q. I'm going to denote this group as GM. It's an algebraic group over Q. And it is actually a subgroup of the rapid decay realization of M. And then this is the motivic Galois group of your object. And then once you have this, the natural thing to do is to conjecture in the spirit of the Grothendieck period conjecture that the transcendent degree of the field generated by the periods of M is equal to the dimension of Gn. Okay, and then what the formalism gives you, more or less for free, once everything is in place, is that this is an upper bound. Okay. And then these conjectures, so in
Like in all the examples I gave you, you can actually compute these groups, and then you find as particular cases of this conjecture usual theorems or conjectures. So Lindemann Weierstrass will be the case of this for the motifs associated to exponentials, or in the case of the gamma values you get. So this example for gamma values you get the transcendent degree of the field generated by gamma values of a fixed denominator is equal to 1 plus phi n over 2, okay, which is a conjecture of Lange, which is only known for n equals 3, 4, 6. Okay, so this was one of the motivations to put all this results conjecture in a like, similar framework to usual periods. And so then let me tell you a couple of more things. So as I said, mx per k contains the usual motifs. By this I mean the category of Norrie as a full subcategory. Okay, but the image is not closed under extension. Okay, so you can prove that this Euler constant motif is not in the doesn't come from a usual motif. And the way you can prove it is that using that this category comes with many. Okay, so we already saw these two realization factors, but there are many others that are in some sense richer than the usual ones. And the one we like very much is the perverse realization. This is a functor that goes from exponential motifs over K to some subcategory of perverse shifts on the affine line. So I'm just going to write perverse zero, so this is a subcategory of perverse shifts with the Q coefficients on the complex affine line. Again, it is the subcategory of those objects with no global cohomology. Okay, so the items to the point is zero. And they are simpler than general perversions because they are all of the forms constructible shift in degree minus one. And then the condition is that this shift has no cohomology. Okay. So you can associate to an exponential motif such a thing. So essentially, without giving too many details, it goes as follows. So you will send hsn of x to the f to the following thing. So you consider the direct image of the constant shift. So this is an object in the derived category of constructible shifts on A1. You can take a perverse cohomology in degree n. In such a way you get a perverse shift. And in general it will not be in this category, but there's a specific projector that is given by additive convolution with something and that puts it in the category. So there you can apply a projector and then you get an object here. And the key point is that this will be a Tanakian category with respect to additive convolution. And usual motifs, they map to a trivial, a sum of copies of the trivial objects. Because in this case, the map is zero. And this is a skyscraper shift, and then this maps this to the unit object. So MK maps to the trivial objects. And
this is the way you can try to detect if something is a usual motif or not. So for example, so let me show you that this conjecture here implies that exponential of alpha is transcendental over the field of periods. So conjecture and period conjecture implies E alpha, or alpha is a non-zero algebraic number, is transcendental over usual periods. Okay, so the way you do this is you take a usual motif n, so it's an object here, and you will consider m plus, which is m direct sum with the guy which produces this video. So expect cube, that's a cube bar minus alpha. Okay, so it was called E alpha before. Okay, so then you have the motivic Galois group of m plus, and of course m generates a subcategory of m plus, so there's a subjection here. Okay. And then the field of periods of M consists of usual periods. The field of periods of M plus consists of these periods plus exponential of alpha. And now the conjecture is that the transcendence degree of these fields is the dimension of the groups. Okay? So what we need to show is that the dimension of this group is always bigger than the dimension of the other. Then the conjecture implies this statement. And then how do we do this? So we are going to exhibit something of positive dimension on the kernel. So you can consider the perverse realization of these things, and they will, so the objects in the Tanakian category, so they will also have groups. So let me call a perverse realization of M, and then perverse realization of M plus. And again, there's a subjection here. And as for any realization function, you get subgroups of the motivic Galois. Now, I said that for a usual motif, this is the trivial trivial object. So this is the zero group. And for this one, you can forget about M. You just need to compute the perverse realization of this. This is an object of rank one. So this is a subgroup of Gn. So you need to decide if it is GM or if it's a group of roots of unity, okay? And then this depends if a convolution power of your thing is zero or not. But a convolution power is going to, so this has singularities at minus alpha, and then if you do tensor 2, it will be minus 2 times alpha, minus 3 times alpha, and so on. And because alpha is not zero, it never gets zero. So, and it was a bit fast, but you get that the group is GM in this case. So this GM is in the kernel, and then this property holds. So this was the promised explanation of why this should have appeared. And I will stop here. Thank you. Are there any questions? It's a self-chair talk.
At the beginning, you gave a lot of examples,
mm-hmm.
and you skipped one with this E, some other n factor. Well, that's of course in your thing because it's E to the alpha.
Yes.
But you said that conjecture the sum one over n factorial squared is not a usual period.
Mm-hmm.
Is it an exponential period?
Yes. So.
It wasn't clear at all.
Not quite. If you multiply it by 2 pi I, then it is an exponential period. Wow. Actually, I don't know if...
You show us that?
Yeah, sure.
Yes. Somehow in your history we're saying what are not usual periods. And you actually left out E, which is the most famous not usual period, but it's obviously an
exponential. But E was...
But it's obviously an exponential period. But we didn't give the...
Do you really mean E?
Well, at the very beginning, I mean, yes. It's erased. You wrote various numbers that are not usual periods,
yes.
Before you said anything about
yes.
Exponential. And they included gamma 1 over n and square root of pi. Mm-hmm. I think in your list, at least in my notes, you didn't have E. Obviously, that was an example. Just a
but E was the first one. It was exponential of alpha.
Oh,
alpha
yeah.
Alpha equals one.
I guess there is an example.
I will show you the Bessel thing. So for Bessel, you take X to be a GM, or Q, and then F is, so it's X plus lambda squared over 4 times X. Okay, this is just cosmetic, you could 1 over X. Okay, so lambda is in Q. And then you find that H1, the RAM, is in this case generated by dx over x and dx, or any other two successive differentials. And then so now you have the puncher complex plane. There's always the cycle coming from the cohomology of GM. And if you draw the region where this is very positive, it is for x positive but very small, and for x positive very big. So you can take as a second cycle the positive real line. Okay, and then if you compute, for example, this integral, so by using Cauchy, this is 2 pi I. And then lambda over 2 to the 2n, n factorial squared. That's a special value of the, I think this is called the Bessel function of the, modified Bessel function of the third kind.
We're now deeply into Whittaker models.
Yes, exactly. And you get 4 numbers, and you can write them. So here is the compact cycle, and here is the real line, and dxx and dx. So this is the first one, 2 pi I, I 0 lambda. Then the second one is minus 2 pi I lambda over 2 I 0 lambda derivative. And then you get the Bessel functions of the second kind. And there's this very curious thing here. So 2 pi I times this, so okay, for lambda equals 2, we will find the number of the at the beginning. So 2 pi I, this is an exponential period. I don't know if the thing individually is an exponential period or not.
Mm-hmm. What's that?
I don't know if this number with no 2 pi I is an exponential period or not.
Can you fill in the matrix? So first, in the
yes.
upper right, that's I0 prime of lambda? So
minus 2 pi I lambda over 2 I0 lambda prime, yeah.
Oh, the prime is
yeah.
Place, okay.
This is also called I1.
Yeah.
And then this is, I think, 2 times K0 lambda, but K0, so this is modified Bessel function of the second kind. And maybe you get lambda over 2. Maybe something like this. And the thing I wanted to say is that, okay, we know from the Sigel-Sidlowski theorem that these two numbers are transcendental and algebraically independent. As far as I know, we don't know anything about this number. So the only thing you can do in this setting is to consider the quotient of the two periods. So you consider the quotient of the two periods. Okay, so dxx dx. And this says that this is a transcendental number. Okay, so this will follow from Sigel-Sidlowski. And it is a bit strange because it's a theorem similar that you take an elliptic curve over Q bar without complex multiplication, then the tau that uniformizes the lattice is transcendental. Except that in that case you fix your holomorphic differential and you integrate over a basis of homology. So here you are doing the opposite thing. You fix a cycle in homology and you integrate over a basis of differential. So, unfortunately, I think this is the only thing you can prove. So the Galois group is GL2. So these 4 numbers should be algebraically independent, but you can only get that the equation of these two is transcendental.
But what about the, I'm just reaching here, but I mean, there's a differential equation.
Yes. So the differential equation is the modified Bessel equation.
Right. Yeah. Well, I mean,
it has...
In lambda.
Yes, it's lambda, I think. As a function of lambda. Yeah. And this one has a differential Galois group SL2. And actually, so I said the group is GL2, and we should understand this GL2 as, okay, once you know the answer, it's not very mysterious, but you should understand GL2 as SL2 GN. But this is, so this is the differential Galois group of the equation. And if you play a little bit about with the Riemann Hilbert correspondence, you can show that this is actually the group of the perversalization. So this will be the subgroup of this. So this explains this inclusion. And if you take the determinant of this matrix, you get up to a multiple, you get 2 pi I. And actually, the determinant motif is a usual motif, so it's something that we have perversalization zero. So, and of course, 2 pi I is a constant from the point of view of differential Galois theory, but it's not a constant from the point of view of motifs.
How general is this? And if you took other irregular differential equations, does this all this work?
It's something general. So, so you will replace your f by minus tf, and then look for the differential equation. So this was your escape, and then from there. So otherwise you take the Picard Fuchs equation corresponding to f, and then you do Fourier transform, and it's the differential equation associated to this.
Nobody has asked this, so I have to say that the same period conjecture implies that the little gamma also is a transcendental number, in fact, even transcendental over the little periods.
Yeah, so in that case, you get as the group is a direct product of, semi-direct product of GM and GA. So it has dimension 2, and the conjecture said that gamma should be, little gamma should be algebraically independent with 2 pi I. And then more, so.
Can you see that e to the 2 pi I equals 1 from
this function?
Sorry? Can you see that e to the 2 pi I is 1?
No, I cannot say this because 2 pi I is not algebraic, so this is
some kind of expansion.
I will have to consider to. As I presented the theory, to be able to talk about this guy, I will need to consider motifs over Q 2 pi I. And I guess one can do it, but when you look at the Grothendieck period conjecture over fields of like really not algebraic, then it works not so well.
And
it
only tells you that it's a rational number.
Okay. Yeah. Which is true.
And a question that is, I think, nothing to do with this lecture, but it's a good place to ask it. Nilo Tkachenko asked me a couple of days ago. If you look at the zero of the, let's say, the smallest zero of J1, or J0, so those are famous numbers, is anything known, anything algebraic? It certainly doesn't look like a period. But can one say anything? They come up all over the place. Mathematics, and there's sort of different class of numbers that if you people think of anything, one can say the zero of the Bessel function. Yeah. I assume the answer is no, it's just an
they appear somewhere in this picture, so there's this this irregular Hodge filtration I was mentioning, and you can try to do the in usual Hodge theory, so you define the complex conjugate thing, and then you try can see that they are opposite in some sense. And this doesn't work. And the reason why it doesn't work is that the Bessel functions have too many zeros. Like, so you will in your period your talk here it will be zero at some point. So it is related to this. But this is the only thing I know.
So I assume the whole panoply of classical differential equations, you just take all Whitaker and Watson and turn the irregular guys into exponential motors.
Yeah, exactly. You can do this for confluent hypergeometric.
Right,
functions.
Exactly, for example.
Yeah. It's a good exercise, a good way of reading the book. And so let me make some advertisement for the talk this afternoon. So there's a talk about generalized Euler constants, which so are. So if you take a K, a number field, and you can look at the Dedekind. You can look at the Dedekind theta function, and that the Taylor expansion around one will be of this shape. Okay, that's higher order. And then you define the generalized gamma of k as the quotient of B and A. Like so. So in this case you get the little gamma for k equals q. And then I would really like to know if these things are exponential periods or related in some sense to them. So. If you have any, please go to the talk, and if you have any answers to these questions, tell me. Okay, thank you.